Hello and welcome. After the previous video, you will have scouted your whole area and you will probably have found a site that you think is perfect for installing a turbine. In this video, we're going to show you the tools and measurement tricks to actually see if that site is feasible. To do that, I will explain you a bit of the methodologies and things we normally use, and of course, what tools you will need. For hydropower, you need two things to generate power: a certain amount of water, or also called flow, and a height for it to fall down from. This height difference is the thing that pushes the water through your turbine, basically. So there's a simple formula to calculate the power of a river or a creek, and it goes like this. The power that's available in your river is equal to the gravitational constant, g, times the flow, in cubic meters per second, times the height difference over which the water falls down. In meter. We will also add a link in the description to a manual that shows all of these formulas and calculations that we use here. Now let's play a little bit with that formula. To maximize your power, you can do two things. You can either have more height or you can have more flow. Now, a lot of the traditional turbines are built for a very large height difference. And that way you get a lot of pressure that's pushing the little bit of water that you have through your turbine. If you look at the formula, you have a lot higher of a head and a very small flow. So to have 10 kilowatts of power, you need 0.05 cubic meter per second of flow, but you also need a height difference of 20 meters to be able to produce that amount of electricity. If you then look at low head hydropower, for instance our vortex turbines, then you see that we have 13 times less height difference than another example. For example, we can use 1.5 meters of height difference to get to that 10 kilowatt, but then we need to recalculate the amount of water that we also pass through that turbine. And recalculating that shows that we now need a flow of 0.68 cubic meters per second, or 680 liters per second. This is of course also 13 times larger than with the high head case. So less head or less height difference means you need more water flowing through your turbine. So that's the formula, and as you can see, these are the two values that you need to know: height and flow. I'll now explain you further how you can measure these. So let's start with height, or also known as head in hydropower. So in low head hydropower, you can have two options. Either you have a sudden drop, or you have a change of height difference that happens over a longer distance, such as this is the case in a lot of rivers with rapids. In the first case, where the drop is quite sudden, calculating it is very easy. To imagine what kind of sites you might have with a sudden drop, you can imagine an existing weir, a small waterfall, or a canal fall, and so on. To measure height, you can use a few tools, or you can just eyeball it. Usually when I see a new site, at first I will just eyeball it, and after that I will start using my tools. So one of the first tools that you can use, and you can also make yourself, is a water level with a ruler. This is basically the DIY version of a topographic station, which is, granted, way more precise, which can be useful if you're also measuring longer distances. And of course, if you want to go super fancy and super precise, you can also always use a drone with some topographical software installed. So if you have a sudden drop, it's really easy to measure. Either you go stand downstream of the small drop and you just look straight ahead. Now, as soon as the upstream water level is at least as high as your eye level, in my case, this is something like 1.7 meters, then you know, okay, this site is suitable for a vortex turbine. It can be more and everything like that, but then at least you know it's good. And then afterwards, you can start measuring with the water level or with the topographic station. Another thing that you can do is make your own water level gauge. This is quite easy to do with some simple flexible tubing and some pieces of wood. We'll post another video about that later on. But the theory goes like this. You have your water level and you try to look past both of the levels at the same time towards a ruler that you have in the distance. From that ruler that you have made before, of course, you can then also read the height difference in centimeters. Except for the DIY method, you can also use a topographic station. This works according to the same principles as the DIY water level, but it's just more precise. You can often rent these machines in your local hardware store. They also are very useful, as I said before, if you want to measure a stream with a very low gradient. If you want to know more on how to use these, it's the same thing as with the other water level, but there's also a lot of manuals online on how to use these kind of things. Now, if you have a river with a low gradient, which is also often the case, you have to make a bit more effort to measure these kind of sites. So with rivers with a low gradient, we will have to be a bit more precise. So we have to do a little bit more effort. But to explain how we are going to do this, I first have to explain you about stream gradient. Now, a stream gradient just means that the river will lose a certain amount of height difference over a certain distance. Out of experience, as a rule of thumb, we can tell you that you have to look for a stream with at least a gradient of 6%. This means 6 meter every 100 meter of length along the river. This will translate then to 2 meter every 30 meters, because this is what we advise as minimum. Then you have to make a bypass canal of 30 meters, which is long enough. You can go up to 100. This just makes it a bit more expensive on the civil works side. Talking about civil works, there are two ways that you can extract energy from a river with a very low gradient. Either you can make a bypass canal, where you put the water in a side river with a lower gradient than the main river, and you basically keep the water at a higher level until it reaches your turbine, and then you drop it back down to the river. Or you can build a weir in the main river, and immediately after that you put your turbine. Now, usually we advise you to make a bypass canal. Not only because it's often cheaper to make than a weir over the whole width of the river, but it's also more ecologically sound. In the case of a bypass, you will put the water that you want to use for hydropower in a side canal that has a lower gradient than the main river, and you will keep it at a higher level until it reaches the turbine. Then you will let it drop through your turbine and go back to the main body of the river. In the other case, where you install a weir, you will have this dam that will increase the water level of the river all the way upstream, and right after that you will have your turbine that will be using that immediate drop of height. So of course, with these kind of low gradient rivers, you can measure the height difference oftentimes with a topographical station. Usually with this kind of equipment, you will be able to see up to 50-100 meters away from you, depending on what kind of zoom you have on your device. And as long as the field of vision is clear, you can just do it with one measurement. If your view is not clear, then you will have to do multiple measurements, but it's also perfectly possible. Just keep a notebook and keep track of your numbers. Now, of course, if you want to map the whole river, the surroundings and everything, to really know well where you can put your civil works and also where they will be safest against a possible flood, we advise to use a drone. Of course, this is not something that everyone has, but it can help you a lot. Now, what we normally do is we have our drone, DJI Mavic Pro, and we use it together with topographical software called Drone Deploy. And in future, we will make our own video on how to do a topography measurement of a river, because there are a few tricks that you need to know about with the reflection of the water, etc. But in the meantime, I'm already adding a link to a topographic video from someone else. Thanks for that, and I hope that will already be clear for you in the meantime. But once the quarantine is over, we can go out there and shoot our own video. So that was all you need to know to measure the height difference. Oftentimes this is quite easy to do, you just have to keep track of those numbers. Now we can go on to the flow measurement. In low at hydro, oftentimes the flows are quite high. This makes them difficult to measure using a standard bucket method. Or you need to have a very big bucket, of course. So what we normally do is the float method. This method is not exactly precise, but it's good enough for our purposes. Don't worry about it. If we're working here with a few hundreds of liters per second, a few liters of measurement error won't have a large impact. So, what will you need? For this float method, you will need a few things. Something that floats, like an orange or a half-filled bottle of water. A phone with a timer. Something to take notes on. and of course, someone who can help you with these measurements. Before you start measuring, you have to find a suitable section of the river. What you want to look for is a uniform stretch of river. No rapids, no bends, no rocks disturbing the flow, just smooth running water. The straighter the better. This is important because in this kind of stretches of river, normally the flow is laminar. Whenever you have turbulence, this kind of measurement method will be less accurate. Now, when you have found your uniform stretch of river, the first thing that you have to do is to measure your cross-sectional area of your river. This is quite straightforward, as you just have to simplify it to your needs. So usually, the cross-sectional area of a river looks like two triangles put against each other. So you can either measure a lot of small sections, but as I said before, we really don't care about precision that much. So what we will do is measure the width till the deepest point of your river. Then you measure the depth at that point, and then you measure the leftover width towards the other side of your stream. And then you will be starting to calculate the cross-sectional area. These formulas will also be added to the document that you can also find in the link below. Cross-sectional area can be calculated as follows. Width of your section times the final depth, divide by 2. And then you do it also for the other triangle. Next, you will then add the two sections together, and that gives you your total cross-sectional area. This cross-sectional area is in square meters, by the way. Next, you have to stand there downstream, and your helper has to walk 10 meters upstream. You also measure that one, 10 meters upstream. This is important because that 10 meter will be your distance, which you will be inputting into your velocity calculation. Here you can see us do this float method in a river in Borneo. One person goes upstream with a half-filled water bottle, and another person is waiting downstream, exactly 10 meters apart. Now, in this case, someone else is taking notes. And what you then do next is you drop the bottle in the water, and you start your timer at that moment. Then the bottle of water will float downstream towards the other person. And as soon as he catches the bottle, you stop your timer. In other words, this is the time it takes for the bottle to float downstream. And this will also give you the velocity of the river. Now be sure to take notes, because usually we have to take these measurements 10 times. You take 10 measurements and then you average the results to get an average stream velocity. This is fairly accurate, actually. So you can now use your notes and use these values to calculate the velocity of the river. Because the velocity of the river is equal to the distance that your bottle had to flow down, divided by the time it actually took to flow between those two points. So in our case, this velocity, which is equal to the distance to float divided by the time it takes to float, is equal to 10 meters of distance between the two people, and it took 8 seconds to float between. So 10 divided by 8 is equal to 1.25 meters per second of velocity. We took this measurement about 10 times, and we took the average of that, still something similar, 1.23 maybe. But then, when you have done this, you can use that average velocity together with the cross-sectional area that you have measured before to calculate your river flow. Because the river flow is equal to the velocity of the stream times the cross-sectional area. In the case of our example, that was 1.25 meters per second times 2 square meters, which is equal to 2.5 cubic meters per second. This is a very respectable flow, and you can probably get something like 30 kilowatts out of this if you have 1 or 1.5 meters of head difference. Now, you have to be very aware that a river flow changes throughout the year. So if you measure this in summer, then the average flow might be a lot higher in wintertime, as there is way more water then. If you don't know the river, please ask some people that live nearby just to make sure that it's correct. And otherwise, you can also look into the databases, flow databases of your local government, to see if you have a correlation between your flow measurement and some upstream or downstream gauging station. At this moment, it's a good time to say something about an extra factor of the formula that I haven't talked about yet, and that's efficiency. Now, when reading about hydropower, you'll notice a lot of numbers are going around for this. After all, hydropower is quite an old industry. And right now, you might have seen numbers like 90 or higher for the efficiencies of a hydropower turbine. Now, this is the case with very large turbines. Imagine a turbine as large as a room or even your house. With these kind of turbines, they are fully optimized and they are fully customized to the site. And except for that, also the leakage losses and the friction losses, etc., will be relatively smaller in relation to the power that the turbine is producing. The losses that you have due to friction or leaks become proportionally larger for smaller turbines than with these kind of big turbines. That's because if you have a leak of 2 millimeters in a large turbine and you make a small turbine, you still will have that kind of tolerance, still 2 millimeter, but now you have relatively way more flow going through that leak than inside your turbine. That's why with smaller turbines you often have to expect lower efficiencies. Or what's also possible, of course, is that you pay for a fully customized turbine, which is of course at a higher cost for a relatively small percentage of extra power. Let's get back to the formula. So now we have everything we need to calculate the total power of the site that you have found, which is, as I will repeat, the hydraulic power available is equal to the gravitational constant G, which is 9.81, times the flow in cubic meter per second, which you have just calculated using the float method, times the height, which you have measured with your topographic station or your water level. All of this together will give you the hydraulic power that you can get out of your turbine, and you can multiply that as a rule of thumb by 0.6 to get the electrical power that you will get out of this site. If this is an interesting site to you, and if you would like to have a vortex turbine to produce sustainable energy, then please send us the document that you have used to fill out to our contact page. And we'll get back to you soon with a suitable turbine design. Now, while we are working on offering you the right size of turbine, you can go ahead to the next video by clicking the link somewhere down here, where we will explain you how to get the legal side of this turbine done, which regulations you have to follow, etc. So thanks for watching and stay safe during these quarantine days. Bye-bye.